Another alternative that we mentioned earlier was that of decreasing the size of transactions themselves. The implication is that if we decrease the size of transactions and keep the block size constant, then we can fit more transactions into the same size blocks. And you can see that in the diagram below, both blockchains are 5 gigabytes after 2 years, but the one with smaller transaction size has twice the number of transactions. This solution is currently a bit more popular with people in general, and we'll be going over two main ways we can decrease transaction size, which are SegWit and recursive SNARKs. SegWit is short for segregated witness, and was originally created to solve an issue in Bitcoin called transaction malleability, which we'll mention later on. Beyond solving transaction malleability though, SegWit also allowed Bitcoin to scale up by decreasing effective transaction size. The way SegWit decreases transaction size is by separating, or segregating, digital signatures from within each transaction. Recall, perhaps from our first course, that signatures in Bitcoin were kept in these script pub keys. The idea behind SegWit is that since digital signatures take up so much space in each transaction, there's no reason they need to be there after they've been used for verification. After all, after one use, the digital signatures don't provide any value, since they're only there in the first place for recipients of transactions to prove that they're authorized to spend from a previous transaction output. There's no reason to keep the signatures except for the first time, so let's just remove all the signatures from the transaction data. From previous sections, we saw that the transaction size is on average about 546 bytes. So if we could decrease that size, that would be pretty awesome. The idea for SegWit was to move the signatures to a separate add-on structure outside of the script pub key, to what's called a segregated witness. In the diagram on the left, you can see that the signatures are located at the end of the transaction, rather than the input script, the script pub key. New nodes would see the new script pub keys that don't contain signatures and then know to look instead in the segregated witness for the signatures. Assuming the signatures are valid, then the transaction is valid. Old nodes, on the other hand, would find these new script pub keys and think that whoever created the transactions are crazy. Without the signature contained in the script pub key like before, new SegWit transactions would seem to be unsafe, though the signature is just in a different place, where old nodes don't know where to look. But in the end, it's not their Bitcoin though, and other users are free to do with their Bitcoin as they please anyways. So old nodes confirm the SegWit transactions as valid, and forward it to other nodes. As you can see from both cases, from the perspective of both old nodes and new SegWit-enabled nodes, the transaction was seen as valid. So, SegWit is compatible as a soft fork. One issue now, though, is that because we segregated signatures from other transaction data, the blockchain doesn't have any evidence that the correct signatures were included in their respective transactions. To fix this, SegWit also comes with a change to the regular Merkle tree structure of Bitcoin. Instead of having a Merkle tree with just transactions, SegWit-enabled miners construct Merkle trees with one half transactions and one half the transaction segregated witness, in a sense creating a mirrored Merkle tree. So this way, we have information about transactions and their segregated witnesses, all contained within the same block header, giving us back all the beautiful properties of tamper evidence. So pros and cons of SegWit. These were debated quite a bit before SegWit was actually implemented. Firstly, SegWit fixes transaction malleability, which we mentioned briefly before. In Bitcoin, unique transaction IDs are calculated by taking a hash of the transaction, and before SegWit, that included the signatures. The only way for attackers to change a transaction ID without changing the underlying transaction is by changing the signatures. And there are ways to change the signature, though it's a bit out of scope. It's a cryptographic vulnerability. Since SegWit removes signatures from the transaction data, signatures are no longer used to calculate a transaction ID, thereby fixing transaction malleability. This allows further blockchain scalability solutions, such as the Lightning Network and sidechains to work, both of which we'll talk about in the coming sections. Another pro is that with SegWit, we have a soft fork instead of a hard fork, compared with what would have happened if we had just directly increased the block size. One of the main motivating factors for implementing SegWit was that Bitcoin Core is generally very conservative and would want to avoid a hard fork at all cost. And that's what they did with SegWit. Some other pros are that it's not subject to slippery slope arguments. SegWit is a one-time fix. It's not like you can just keep removing data from transactions to decrease transaction size. So it's not like what we could do with increasing block size, where there wasn't really a cap of how large we can make it. Also, of course, the efficiency gains with SegWit are pretty nice. Smaller transactions means that it's less for miners to parse through. And we also have a smaller blockchain size for the amount of transactions we want to represent. As for cons, we know that SegWit is only a one-time linear capacity increase. Since we can only remove signatures from transactions once, it's not like we can keep removing signatures, right? So that's where the one-time comes from. And the increase is only linear because decreasing the transaction size by removing signatures only increases the number of transactions in a block linearly with respect to the block size. Another con is that in implementation, SegWit isn't the prettiest. It's proven to be very complicated and ugly with over 500 lines of code. And compound the difficulty of implementation with the fact that wallets would have to implement SegWit as well, and that these wallet software developers might not get their SegWit implementations right the first time, or might take a while to upgrade, especially if the team behind it is small, and that could mean some losses for the average Bitcoin user. And finally, SegWit isn't the only way to fix transaction malleability. So as the Bitcoin scalability debate reached its climax, Bitcoin split into Bitcoin Cash, which increased the block size to 8 megabytes, and Bitcoin, which kept its block size at 1 megabyte but enabled segregated witness. This was on August 1st, 2017, at block number 478,558. The next on-chain vertical scalability topic we'll cover hinges on the concept of zero-knowledge proofs, an advanced topic in cryptography. Zero-knowledge proofs are a way to prove to someone that you know something without revealing what exactly you know. So the recipient of the proof has zero knowledge of what you know, except for the fact that they know you know something. You can think of it like how you authenticate yourself on websites where you have to log in with a username and password. If the website stored your actual password, that would be a pretty horrible security practice, since all it takes now is one data leak and now all your users' identities are compromised. Instead, websites usually store a hash of your password itself. If the password you input when you log in hashes to the same string as the website saved password hash, then you've been authenticated. The website knows that you know your password, but they themselves don't know your password, only the hash of it. Note that this analogy was to explain the concept of zero-knowledge proofs and is not meant to be taken at any deeper level. And so with our high-level understanding of zero-knowledge proofs, we can begin to understand ZK-SNARKs, which stand for Zero-Knowledge Succinct Non-Interactive Arguments of Knowledge. A pretty big mouthful. Instead of Alice sending a transaction from Alice to Bob, she can replace that transaction with a proof that she has sent a valid transaction to Bob, and the corresponding changes to a virtual balance sheet. This is a lot smaller than the original transaction itself. And also, with the smaller size and the way we construct and verify these proofs, any machine in the network can verify the proof in milliseconds. That's the main idea behind ZK-SNARKs. And it gets better. We can introduce a recursive structure. A miner can merely include a single proof that they validated all the other proofs and changes to the state of the network and everyone's balances. Instead of having transactions inside blocks, our new blockchain construction would have just the following components. 1, the root hash of the content of the ledger. 2, proofs for all valid transactions that have changed the ledger to the current state, and 3, proof that the previous block's proof was valid. All in all, this would allow anyone in the world to verify the blockchain in under 1 second, and also allows for twice as many transactions per block. The average transaction size, as we saw earlier, was 546 bytes, and compare this with the average proof size, which is around 288 bytes. For some closing thoughts, let's look back at our previous slide. Back to Alice and Bob, Alice generates a proof that she can send a valid transaction to Bob. She includes this proof in any changes to a balance sheet instead of including a transaction, and any machine in the network can verify the proof in milliseconds. However, there do exist some pretty big drawbacks. Firstly, in practice, these proofs are very time-consuming to generate and could potentially take hours. Secondly, part of the proof construction requires a trusted setup between computers. Trusted setup, perhaps like trusted execution environments, which we discussed in week one. Ultimately, the time it takes to generate proofs counteracts whatever scalability benefits we saw earlier with the reduced data size. And also, the trusted setup violates the trust assumptions, especially in public blockchains. So we've been playing with a bunch of parameters, such as block size, size of transactions, and block rate. But we haven't really been able to reach amazing numbers. It's clear that we need to change something else, but we've ran out of parameters to play with. The key observation here is that all scaling solutions we've seen so far are layer 1 scaling solutions. So in the next section, we'll look at layer 2 solutions. Let's just not use the blockchain.